I imagine when I'm thinking back to when I would get ready for services on Sunday morning, and sometimes Dad would look at what I had picked out and kind of not give it another glance, and then sometimes he'd look at what I picked out. You could tell not everything was quite right. I often wondered if he looked at me and thought, "Son, did you turn the light on when you picked your clothes out this morning?" Truth be told, probably not. This morning's sermon, and the reason why I asked Bob to pick songs that he liked is because there aren't too many songs on the subject of modesty. The only song that even mentioned clothing that I could think of was the one, you know, "Beautiful Robes of White," "Beautiful Land of Light," and so on and so forth. But not so many songs on this particular subject. This is a subject that falls in the category of things people which preachers would leave them alone about. Folks don't like when preachers talk about our wallet, our closet, or our bedroom. But it is something that needs to be talked about, because it is something that all of us did, thankfully, this morning, was pick something to wear. Lord willing, we'll all pick something tomorrow morning to wear. And what we pick to wear matters, because there's a lot of different things we can do with that. Discussions, I've heard more than one of these sermons, and truth be told, I wasn't asked to preach this. I don't have an axe to grind, nor do somebody have one and ask me to grind it for them. But I've found that in these sorts of discussions, modesty, it usually follows one of two lines of thinking. Usually the sorts of questions that are asked are the wrong questions. If you picked up a bulletin this morning, not only is the outline in the middle, but almost the entire introduction's in there, mainly because I wanted to make sure I said what I wanted to say. So if I mess up here, what I want to say is in the bulletin, so read that. You'll be better off. But normally discussions on modesty follow one of two lines of thinking. The first line is the line I like to call the school code of conduct line. I spent a few years as an educator and quite a few as an educatee, you know, student. And when they talked about what you could wear in school and we as teachers, what we should address in our students, these are the sorts of questions, right? How long does the clothing have to be? How short can it not be? How tight is too tight? How loose is too loose? And how much skin can show and which skin can show? And correct me if I'm wrong, but this is still the way it's talked about today. You also hear questions that are more centered on not where's the line, but who's drawing it. Questions that sound as if we're to take a poll of the culture we're in to see what's acceptable in our country, in our time, and so on. And our cultures, this is putting it lightly, but they're not really a great source of guidance on a lot of stuff. Clothing, maybe most of all. Our culture forgot who boys and girls are. I mean, are we going to trust them for what to wear? You know? We claim to be people who live our lives by the Word of God. What does it have to say about our clothing? Now, I will give you a couple of things. Number one, the Word of God doesn't give you X number of inches above the knee. The straps have to be so wide and so on. But there are some things the Bible says that I want to talk about this morning. And I hope you have a bulletin. If you don't have one now, make sure you grab one on the way out. Everything I'm going to say this morning is in there. Here's what I want to talk about in terms of modesty. Now, before we go into all this, I ask you to keep an open mind and an open Bible. This is not going to be the hour where you check your Twitter, check your Facebook, write notes to your friends, all the other sorts of stuff that we do. This also isn't the hour where we start preparing roast preacher for on the way home. You know, you've heard that one before. Everyone has roast preacher on the way home. Just follow me on this. What I'm going to give you this morning aren't my opinions, but they are, as best as I can tell, what the Scripture says. Here are your four better questions we need to ask concerning modesty. Number one, you know I'm going to the Old Testament, right? How did God clothe us in the very beginning? Truth be told, there were no fashion designers in the garden. There was only God. And there was only Adam and Eve. And they were naked, as you might remember. And God clothed them initially. So how did he do it? Why did he do it the way that he did? Secondly, why all of a sudden in between Genesis 2 and 3 did nakedness become shameful? We talk about the need to cover up. We argue about, well, how long does it have to be you cover up with? Why do we need to cover up in the first place? Why is it shameful? This is something that doesn't often get talked about. Thirdly, what do the clothes that I pick reveal about me? You hear it in today's culture, you know, what you wear needs to make a statement. Well, what are you saying with the clothing that you pick out? You may be saying more than you realize. Fourthly, does my clothing choice coincide with my purpose? Why am I here on this earth? Why am I doing what I'm doing? And do my clothing choices go along with that? Those are the four questions I want to answer. Lord willing, we'll be able to do it before 5. No, we're going to try way before that. But I want to answer these four questions for you and go through the scriptures and examine what it says. So you remember what I said, open mind, open Bible. If you have a Bible, open it, or open the app if you have one of those crazy things. All right, let's talk about it. This is Genesis 3. Follow along with me. Genesis, the third chapter, and verse 7. Adam and Eve find themselves naked. Now, we're going to talk about why they were naked and why they felt this way in just a second. But when you start thinking about clothing from the beginning, the first two articles of clothing in the Bible are the two things that Adam and Eve made for themselves out of, as it says, their fig leaves. Genesis 3 and verse 7 says, "Then the eyes of both were opened, and they knew that they were naked." So there's a need. We're going to talk about why in a minute. But it says at the end of verse 7, "They sewed fig leaves together and made themselves," the ESV says, "loincloths." Loincloth is probably the best common word for the thing they made. In the King James, they call it aprons. Now, I know in our mind, we think apron as, you know, the square here and down. The New American Standard calls it just simply waist coverings. The word that's used there is a Hebrew word. The root of it is kagor, if I've said it right. And kagor in the Bible, in the Old Testament, 99% of the time refers to a belt. Not a, you know, pair of shorts or something like that. In 2 Samuel 18 and verse 11, the man who told Joab that Absalom's son was hanging in a tree, you might remember he's hanging by his hair, kind of a comical scene, but really a sad one. Joab tells him that if he would have killed Absalom, he would have given him, quote, 10 pieces of silver and a belt. Now the word for belt is the same one used back in Genesis 3. To describe the thing Adam and Eve made out of fig leaves. Same reference in 2 Kings chapter 2 and verse 5. David warns Solomon about Joab. He describes him as a man of war, a man who's willing to kill people in times of peace. And the way he does that is he says, "The blood of war on the belt around his waist." Belt, again, same word as the thing Adam and Eve made. You see the same thing in Isaiah chapter 3. When Isaiah is warning Judah about the captivity that's coming, the horrors of the exile, Judah's going to have to give up all of their good clothing, including their nice embroidered girdles, and instead wear ropes around their waists. Same word. I say all that to say this. The garment that Adam and Eve made for themselves wasn't proper clothing. And I think we would admit, even today in 2022, with all the craziness in our culture, we still recognize that going out in public with only a belt on is problematic. You're not allowed to do that, even in our crazy world. If you go back to Genesis chapter 3, do you remember what Adam and Eve did when they heard the sound of the Lord God moving through the garden? Genesis 3 said they hid themselves. Why? Well, they realized they were still naked. They realized the thing they made for themselves wasn't good enough. In Genesis 3 and verse 21, God makes both of them not belts, but garments. Depending on your translation, it may say garment, it may say coat, it may say tunic. Very different Hebrew word in this case. The word here is ketheneth. Ketheneth refers to a coat more often than it does anything else. When Jacob gives his favorite son Joseph the coat of many colors, it's the same word as the thing God made for Adam and Eve in Genesis chapter 3. The priests in Exodus chapter 28, both the high priest and all of his sons, were required to wear various garments, one of them being, it says, a robe or a tunic. Same word. You remember the story of Nadab and Abihu? Nadab and Abihu, they bring, as it says, strange fire, one translation says, before the Lord, and God strikes them dead. They are carried out in their coats, it says. Now, let's be honest. We've all seen people wearing things that if you had to carry them out in those clothes, it ain't happening. Right? There's just not enough fabric there. But Nadab and Abihu were carried out in their ketaneth, in their coat. Must be a large garment. Finally, 2 Samuel 13, there's a really tragic story of Amnon, David's son, who takes advantage of his sister Tamar, who we're going to talk about in just a second. But the garment she's described as wearing, a long, flowy kind of gown with long sleeves, is a ketaneth, the same word, right? New King James actually calls it a robe of many colors, which is an interesting reference. The word indicates the sort of clothing God made to clothe Adam and Eve with. And the thing we can figure out from Genesis 3 is pretty simple. God saw the loincloth they had on and decided, that's not nearly good enough. And He clothes them with something completely different. I think it's important to notice from this, number one, more than the private areas had to be covered. That seems to be the one line that our culture even tries to draw. As long as the, you know, gender-specific organs are covered, then you're fine. That's not the case. The idea behind a tunic or coat or something to that regard is that the area between the shoulders and the knees and perhaps further is covered. We're going to make that point even more clear in just a few minutes. But loincloth, now here's another point. Loincloth means that Adam and Eve were uncovered from the waist up. It's not like you see in the little kids Bible class where Eve's covered up like with leaves or something like that. Mm-mm. You don't wear a belt up here. And yet God saw that and said, you're naked. He said you're naked to both the man and the woman, interestingly. Now later on, there is going to be gender-specific clothing, and we're going to see that God requires men to wear men's clothing and women to wear women's clothing. That much is clear. But in the beginning, the standard for what had to be covered for men and women was the same. Shoulders to knees. Thirdly, and this is the thing I think we miss. Go back a second. All of these folks we just talked about, Jacob, the priests, Nadab and Abihu, Tamar, they're all important people, right? They're all people that God, they're considered valuable. Joseph is the favorite son. The priests are important people. Nadab and Abihu were important people. Tamar is a daughter of the king. God putting a tunic on Adam and Eve meant more than just they had to be covered. It meant they were important. It meant they were valuable to God. Now, all that being said, why? Why was their nakedness shameful? Because you got to reckon with this. In Genesis 2 and verse 25, before the events of the chapter 3, the man and his wife were both naked and were not ashamed. Think about it. They were married. That's the reference in chapter 2 to Adam and Eve. They're married folks. Sometimes it's a big news flash. Married folks see each other naked. It happens. And it's okay in that context. But in Genesis 3, there's no one else on the planet. There's no one there to see either of them naked other than each other. You might say God, but God made them that way. So then why, in 3 and verse 7, did they look at themselves and say, we got to have something on? What happened between Genesis 2, 25 and 3,
7.
What happened to cause Adam and Eve to make for themselves basically fig leaf hula skirts and then hide from God because they were naked? Who told them they were naked? The thing that happens between the end of chapter 2 and verses 9 and 10 was knowledge. It says in Genesis 3 and verse 7, the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. This is far more than just an acknowledgement that we don't have clothes on. You might remember the thing that they eat from, the thing that they ate from was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Before they ate from the tree. This is hard to think about because it's not the world we live in. But before they ate of the tree, they didn't know what lust was. It didn't exist. They didn't know about any form of sexual perversion. They didn't know homosexuality could be a thing. Granted, it's just those two, but they didn't have any idea of the concept. They didn't know about they didn't know about any of the just list of things that we know full well about in our culture. There was no such thing as sexual temptation in Genesis 2 because there was no knowledge of it. But all that changed when they ate of the tree. The reason why they knew they were naked is because they now knew all of the things I just described were possible. And in Genesis 2, there was no need to cover the body because they didn't know the evil that comes from uncovering it. It didn't exist. That's why moving forward in the Bible, nearly universally, when you see someone uncovered, it's a source of great shame. Noah's sons walk in on him naked in Genesis chapter 9, and it's a source of great shame. In Exodus, the 28th chapter, verses 40 and 43. Do you have your Bible? Exodus 28, follow me to verse 40. This is in the description of the priestly garments. And they had to wear several things. Even folks who were just priests, not the high priest, they had to wear a very specific outfit. But part of this outfit was an undergarment. It says in Genesis, or rather Exodus 28 and verse 42, it says, "You shall make for them linen undergarments to cover their naked flesh. They shall reach from the hips to the thighs. And they shall be on Aaron and on his sons when they go into the tent of meeting, or when they come near to the altar to minister in the holy place, lest they bear guilt and die. This shall be a statute forever for him and for his offspring after him." The thing the priests had to wear under their garments went from the hips and the thighs, and it was to cover their called naked flesh. This meant that not only were the hips included in the naked category, I mean, Adam and Eve even knew that, but the thighs included in that too. Now, just a brief side note, can you imagine a priest trying to work out how much thigh he can show off? Right? That doesn't make sense. It's like if we use the school technique, right? Can they go, can I show off 5 inches? That doesn't make any sense. I don't see the priest trying to work this out when they see Nadab and Abihu get struck dead. Theirs wasn't for nakedness, but you understand the idea. So then why do we do that? Look at 2 Samuel 10. This is a tremendous passage. 2 Samuel chapter 10 is in the life of David. Now we need a bit of backstory. 2 Samuel 10, David sends ambassadors, lack of a better word, to the family of an Ammonite king who just died. David had been loyal in his dealings with the Ammonite king. The Ammonite king passes away. And so kind of as a show of good faith or as a show of continued loyalty, David sends ambassadors kind of with a message of consolation, right? With a message of, we're sorry this has happened. Let's continue to be friends. Well, when the ambassadors show up in 2 Samuel 10, the advisors to the Ammonite king, they say something along the lines of, you know, they're not really here to console you. They're here to spy out the land. They want to see what's up with Ammon so that they can come over and attack. They're not really here on good terms. And so the Ammonite king's son in verse 10 does, or 10 and verse 4 does something despicable. Hanan took David's servants and shaved off half the beard of each and cut off their garments in the middle at their hips and sent them away. When it was told David, he sent to meet them, for the men were greatly ashamed, it says in the first half of verse 5. Now it's interesting in verse 4, the garments that they were wearing were cut in half at the middle at the hips. Now unless they wear their hips just over their shoes, at the middle at the hips means the garment goes halfway as far up as it does down. And the Ammonite king cuts their garment in half to shame them. We've seen folks wear what could accurately be described as something they bought at the half-off sale and not be ashamed of it, as David's servants were. In Isaiah 47, verses 2 and 3, Babylon would one day be humiliated instead of glorified. And the shame that Babylon would experience was described this way. It says, strip off your robe, uncover your legs, your nakedness shall be uncovered, a little further along that same passage, and your disgrace shall be seen. The Bible uses the idea of uncovering someone's nakedness almost exclusively to describe sexual activity. Call it a phrase that's kinder than the act itself. You can see that in Leviticus 18, Leviticus 20, and Ezekiel 16, and so on. This all tells us something important. Our clothing has a more fundamental purpose than to make a fashion statement. Our clothing, all the way from Genesis 3 to present day, is for the purpose of covering up nakedness, and it is to prevent revealing it. At some point in the modesty discussion, we all have to be big boys and girls about this. We know full well that the region between the shoulders and knees can be, quote, covered in such a way that it actually reveals what's underneath. And this is true for men and women. And it's something that we need to do better at. But secondly, think about this. Our clothing choices have to acknowledge the fact that we live in a world full of sexual sin. And we do this in other contexts, and we don't have a second thought about it. Does anyone else not tell their kids they're not allowed to ride their bicycles in the highway? I know my dad did. I know I've told mine, no, you're not riding your bicycle in the street. Why? Well, I know everybody should pay attention. I know people driving should look out for bicyclists. And I know the road is an amazing place to ride a bicycle. I mean, it's paved, it's smooth, it's flat, all that stuff. So why don't we send our kids out on the road to go ride their bikes because, well, you know, they shouldn't be running over our children? Well, because we know better. We know that terrible things happen when we do that. In spite of what should happen, we know what does happen. So then why do we advocate wearing clothes that aren't fit for anywhere on the basis of, well, they shouldn't be lusting? Well, you shouldn't be looking at me that way. We all know that our houses should not be robbed, and yet we lock the doors, don't we? Our clothing choices have to account for the fact that we live in a world full of pedophiles. We live in a world where cell phone videos and pictures exist. We live in a world where creepy people show up to public events to see young ladies and young men undressed, partially. That's where we live. We don't live in this utopia where nothing ever bad happens. We live in a world of Genesis 3, where the knowledge of good and increasingly the knowledge of evil is everywhere. We've got to be upfront about that. It's a tired old argument. Well, they shouldn't be lusting after me. Why do I have to hide what I've got? Look at my assets. Look how wonderful I look. You live in a world that will take advantage of you. And our clothing should safeguard as best we can against that. We can't prevent it all by what we wear. I understand that. But if we're willing to lock the doors and not ride our bikes in the road, we've got to be willing to dress like we live in a world that knows about sexual sin. Thirdly, what's my clothing say about me? Once I get myself sufficiently covered, is that all I have to worry about? Genesis, the 38th chapter. Follow along with me. This is Genesis 38, verse 14. There are two Tamars in the Old Testament. The first, we mentioned, the daughter of David, who was taken advantage of by Amnon. Actually, she's the second. The first is Judah's daughter, Tamar. Without going into the full story, Tamar is in mourning. And it's easily recognizable that Tamar is wearing garments of mourning, because in Genesis 38, 14, it says she took off her widow's garments, garments that would have indicated she was bereaved. And as the story goes, she took off those garments and covered herself with a veil, wrapping herself, and sat at the entrance to Enaim. Now, the reason she did that was essentially to solicit or to be a prostitute. And worse, to do so in front of her father-in-law, Judah. Judah correctly read the message that her clothes sent. Judah doesn't come up and ask whether she's a prostitute. He knows she's a prostitute. And what's interesting culturally about this, in that time and place, if you wanted to advertise that you were a prostitute, you didn't reveal everything you had. You actually covered yourself and hooded, veiled yourself so that you were anonymous. So that nobody really knew who you were. So then you could practice prostitution. In our culture, we uncover to advertise sexual availability. Solomon didn't need to explain to his son in Proverbs 7:10 what a prostitute looked like. He just said, "Behold, a woman meets him dressed as a prostitute." What a person wears declares their intent. And on the other hand, we have the extremely positive examples of what's called for in the New Testament. In terms of modesty discussions, the well-worn passages, 1 Timothy 2 and 1 Peter 3, which are good, great passages for this, but notice what's discussed. The issue in 1 Timothy 2 isn't underdressing or over-revelation. The issue in 1 Timothy 2 is actually too much. An excess, a gaudiness to what is worn. There was a preacher I heard preach on the subject. His name is Jeff Wilson. He made an incredible insight. You know, in our culture, if you have a credit card, you can have basically whatever you want in just a little while. If you have a credit card, you can get a hairdo costing thousands of dollars. You can go shop wherever you want, and you can buy a lot of jewelry. And in short order, you can look just like this. In their culture, you couldn't do that. There was no credit cards or anything like that. In their culture, the only people who had this stuff were the ones who could afford it. And so why would they wear it? Well, to show off. Look how well-to-do I am. I'm a person of means, or my family of people of means. It's advertising. It's a demonstration of wealth. Christians aren't to be sending a message of wealth with what they wear. On the other hand, they're to be dressed, as it says, modestly. With self-control, not with excess, but with restraint as to what they wear. The Christian women of 1 Peter 3 are described in terms of the same thing. It says, "Don't let your adorning be external, the braiding of hair and putting on of gold jewelry, the clothing you wear." What is to adorn us is not the beautiful, attractive things we wear. That's not a thing. I'm not saying you can't wear beautiful, attractive things, but that's not what adorns us as people. What adorns us, or what makes us beautiful or attractive, is, as it says here, the hidden person of the heart. I've been to several nursing homes. Why don't folks in nursing homes dress like high schoolers? Why not? They're done making statements with what they wear. This isn't to say they dress poorly. I've known ladies in nursing homes who dress extremely well. But they're done trying to send messages to folks. And they're dressing to cover themselves. Think about what our clothing choices can say. There are entire lines of clothing, the names of which you know full well, that exist for the sole purpose of showing the world, I can afford this. Not that it looks any better or if it's made of different fibers, they're not made of solid gold, but it's names on the fabric that say, I am a person of means, and if you wear this, you can hang out with other people like that. Right? Sometimes the things we put on say, I'm a wealthy person. Sometimes the things we put on say, look, I am physically and sexually attractive. I am available. Why do you suppose high schoolers dress like peacocks? For the same reason peacocks have all the feathers. They're trying to show out. Sometimes we dress in ways that say, I am a physically strong, intimidating person. If you ever go to a sporting goods store, look at the male mannequins. I have yet to run into a man that looks like any of those. They're terrifying. I mean, they're like Popeye everywhere, you know. But we want to look like that. So that's what we wear. Sometimes we dress as if we're intelligent. Nothing wrong with that, I suppose. Sometimes we dress as if we don't care about ourselves. This was always a red flag when we were teachers, when I was a teacher. If you saw someone whose clothing drastically went downhill in a hurry, something's wrong. They need attention. They need help. Sometimes we dress in the theme of I like fill in the blank. Entertainers, musicians, beverages, food, sports teams. I realize I had a shirt in my closet with a taco on the front of it. You know? And sometimes we dress to say, I identify with this group. This is what it was when I was in high school. You could tell the groups of people based on what they wear, right? Very clearly delineated groups. Sometimes we dress in such a way that say, I don't care what anybody thinks. I do my own thing. And sometimes we dress in ways that say, I'm better than you spiritually. You might remember the Pharisees had that problem. It was required in the law that their garments have fringes. And so what they would do is they'd make those fringes absolutely as big as they could. Just to show, I'm just a little bit better than all the rest of you. Now it's not wrong to be wealthy or attractive or strong or intelligent. But we need to remember our purpose. My choice in clothing should coincide with a desire to please God first, and then with anything else I'm trying to say with it. One last thing. Do our clothes coincide with our purpose? When you compare what we wear to some scriptures in the New Testament, you have to ask yourself, do I look the part or do I not? When I'm described as a temple of the Holy Spirit, 1 Corinthians chapter 6, do I look that way? I'm not saying you need to dress as a billboard. But do I look like a person who, if the Holy Spirit's within me, is the Holy Spirit comfortable or uncomfortable with what I have on? Am I a person who is dressed as a living sacrifice to the God of heaven? Brother Bob mentioned this passage on Wednesday night about being conformed versus transformed. Are we conformed to the world's fashion standards? Or do we look like people who are a little bit different? The Amish get a knock for their clothes a lot. Make fun of them. Oh, those folks don't have any zippers. I'll tell you what, they're modestly dressed. And you can tell right off the bat who they are. I'm not saying we all need to wear straw hats, but there's some positive things there. Does my clothing fit Philippians 2? Kids, when your parents tell you to change, you go change and you don't grumble. Because parents are in charge of the modesty of their children. And they're to do all things without grumbling and disputing. Parents and children alike, do we look like we're dressed as lights in a dark world? Does my clothing qualify as honorable, pure, lovely, commendable, and so on? In terms of suggestions on what to wear, don't take what I wear as a suggestion, okay? This is just what I found. But think about the folks we mentioned in the beginning. Dress like your father thinks you're the most important person in the world. Dress like serving God is your profession. It is your calling. It's what glorifies you, the fact that you get to serve the God of heaven. Dress like your father is king. Queen Elizabeth II passed away recently. She dressed like someone important. Not saying we need to wear crowns, but she dressed in such a way that showed her respect for herself and for those who are around her. Clothe yourself in honor of Jesus. This is the last thing, and then the lesson will be yours. Roman history records that when crucifixion was done, different from how you might have seen it painted or depicted, crucifixions were done naked. They would take all the clothes off a person and then crucify him. And we have some evidence to that effect in John's Gospel, in chapter 19, verse 23. They took Jesus' kethenet, they took his outer garment, it's in Greek, so it wouldn't have been that word, but they took his outer garment, and then they took his inner garment, his tunic, and crucified him naked as the day he was born. Jesus was crucified as naked as when Adam and Eve found out they were sinful. And he went through that for you and for me. He suffered the extreme shame of nakedness so that we wouldn't have to suffer the shame of our deeds being naked before the Father. As it says in Hebrews 4, no creature is hidden from his sight. You have an opportunity this morning to cleanse your robes, to be clean, to not have to stand before God ashamed. And that comes by obeying the gospel. It was read a few moments ago about a group of people, Revelation 7, who had washed their robes, made them white. You can do that this morning. Through obedience to the gospel, you can put on, as John describes, spiritually speaking, those robes of white. And you can stand one day without shame in front of God. If you're a Christian, God is faithful to forgive us if we will ask Him to cleanse us once again.